Hello, hello.
Hello. I'm Tristan. It's nice to meet you. Welcome to FCC. Nice to have you if it's your first time. I don't know if there's still some people at the back, but... Oh, no, there's not. My bad. But yeah, in the first service, we were just sharing, we had a... it was like a youth rise up. It's called Rise Up, but it was with all the youths from all the NCMI churches. And we had it here on the Friday night. So it was really, really awesome. But we were trying to get teenagers to stand up and worship God without making it too exciting and hyped up. That's a challenge. It's so hard. And I mean, it's you guys aren't much better, but I'm not joking. Not joking. But I wanted to share same thing what I shared that night, and I think it's important to remember before you go into a time of worship. But it's in John chapter 4, verse 24. It says, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth. And I just wanted to encourage, you know, we can come into worship and we can often come with the same formula. We want it to be the same, you know. Like, let it be the same. I don't want anything new. So I'm going to do the same things. I'll raise my hand in the second song. I'll start praying in the third. Someone will come up and share a nice word and I'll feel encouraged. But if you don't feel like that, there's nothing wrong. Come to God honestly. Like it said, come in truth. Come as yourself. So if you want to sit, stand. Just come to God and come to Jesus honestly. So let's stand. I'm on band as well. So I have to... I just have to pray and then go there. But Lord, I just want to say thank you. Thank you that we come to you today in worship. And I pray, Lord, that we humble ourselves, that we open our hearts to you, and that you minister to us, Lord. It's such a privilege to be here and in your presence, Lord. Thank you.
Only Jesus, you are the way, the truth, and the life.
You are the blood, the water, the vine. You are the word and you are the light. Only Jesus, only Jesus, only Jesus, who is truest life. Only Jesus Christ, only Jesus, only Jesus, who is lifted high. Only Jesus Christ. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the blood, the water, the vine. You are the word, and you are the light. Only Jesus, only Jesus. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the blood, the water, the vine. You are the word, and you are the light. Only Jesus, only Jesus. Only Jesus, who is true is life. Only Jesus Christ. Only Jesus, only Jesus, who is lifted high. Only Jesus Christ, only Jesus, only Jesus. It's only Jesus. Thank you.
Friends, I said this in the first service and I feel it applicable again. Band, don't switch your notes. I'm going to ask you to sing that again. For this reason, Hosanna, right? We may be singing it this morning. Maybe you know what it means. Maybe you don't. But I want to encourage you with this. That same word has been worshipped, has been used to worship Jesus for thousands of years. The story records in the Bible when Jesus rides into the city, they lay palms in front of him and they are singing that exact word, Hosanna. It's intrinsically connected to the person they are worshiping. Hosanna in the Old Testament, God saves us, becomes Hosanna. Blessed be the man who comes in the name of the Lord, becomes Hosanna in the New Testament because Hosanna is Jesus. He is the word. You may replace Hosanna with Jesus as you worship today, but know that you are serving a God of eternity. Know that you are serving a God that was served thousands of years ago. They recognized him and they worshiped Hosanna. That word is everything, friends. That word encapsulates everything that we need. Jesus is everything that you need. And so I'm going to ask the band to sing that one more time. And what it is that you need, friends, is Jesus. And so wherever you find yourself this morning, whether you are able to lift your hands in worship, or whether you are opening up your hand and say, God, save me, Jesus is the answer. So shall we do that again? And join with me as we worship the God of eternity that has been worshipped over thousands of years. And may his name be proclaimed in this house this morning.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh.
Now and forever, God.
thank you, Lord. Father, what a powerful name it is. Lord, as we stand here this morning, we are reminded, Lord, that salvation, forgiveness is found in the name of Jesus. That more love than we could ever imagine is found in the name of Jesus. Father, you have given us everything in your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we stand here this morning, my prayer for all of us, Lord, including myself, is that, Father, we would have a realization of what it means to be a son or a daughter of the Most High. That we would have a realization of what it means to serve the name of Jesus. That the name of Jesus has washed us clean, now and forevermore. That the name of Jesus connects us in a way deeper than there is any human explanation for. That the name of Jesus gives us a peace that surpasses all understanding, that as we stand here, Father, we know that you've got this. Because we know Jesus. And because we know Jesus, we know you, Lord. We thank you for the name of Jesus. Father, my prayer for all of us this morning is that we would know your name, that we would live your name, that your name would be tattooed over our hearts this morning. The name above all names. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, band. Thank you, guys. You may take your seats. Good morning to those who snuck in after the first song and maybe you didn't get a chance for us to greet you. Hello. Welcome. My name is Shaul. I'm just one of the guys here. And it would be great to meet with you maybe afterwards with a cup of coffee. There's a QR code behind me which you can use your smartphone. It'll take you to our website. It'll tell you a little bit about us. And I did this in the first service, and I'm going to do it again. Let me tell you quickly, shortly, about us. We are Foy's Community Church. We love Jesus, which I think you would have noticed by now, I hope. And we love God's people. We love people. We are a family of believers. I say, you know, you'll hear Tony speak of it a little bit later. We really are a family. You know, I joined this family 15 years ago, and we have everything in this family. We've got the crazy aunts. We've got the strict grandfathers. You know, we've got them too. We've got the young brothers and sisters that we always got to call back and say, hey, I don't know if you've got a young brother. I've got one of those. We really are just a family of believers. And the things that tie us together, and I thought, oh, this is so cheesy, but let me say it in any event. You know, they say blood is thicker than water, right? Family. The thing that connects this family is the blood of Jesus. And yes, I know that's cheesy, but it is what it is. It's the truth, correct. The blood connects us. Thicker than anything you will ever know, I promise you. I am closer to some of the people in this church than I am to the blood relatives that flow through my veins, because we are connected by the blood of Jesus. And so feel encouraged. If you're visiting us for the first time, maybe you visit us for a few times, and you want to be part of a family, welcome home. Scan the QR code and let's get to know you, and let's get to really do life together. One of the things that we are going to do very, very soon, this Friday, I think, in fact, is come dine with us. So Come Dine With Us is an awesome event we've been speaking about it the last few weeks, where we're going to go to people's homes. You don't know where you're going, you don't know who you're hosting, but you're going to go for dinner, and it's going to be a lot of fun, where you get to just share a meal with people in the life of this church, and you get to know your family a little bit better. It's an awesome, awesome event. Registrations do close tomorrow, if I'm not mistaken. So please, if you haven't registered, please do so. It's extremely important, and I don't want you to wake up Wednesday morning and go, man, I wish I had registered for Come Dine With Me, because it really is going to be a lot of fun. Okay. And then, of course, it's 100 Rand per head. Please do also remember to pay, as we're going to use that money. We'll go to the host to help them cater for the food and everything else. We've also got a prayer cafe happening tonight. Prayer cafe is a wonderful time, again, where the family gets together. We pray for each other. We pray for this family. We pray for the extended family, the people who call themselves followers of Jesus, and we pray into this world, because this world needs prayer. And as I said, thousands and thousands of years, people have been worshiping the name Hosanna. For thousands of years, they've been praying for each other, praying for everybody that follows Jesus. And so tonight at 6 p.m., please could I encourage you guys, if you haven't attended one of these prayer cafes, it's awesome. It's a fantastic time to just gather and pray. All right. Then lastly, before Tony's going to come up, we're going to send around the baskets, the tithes and offerings. If you haven't been here before, don't worry. I've said it once before that and you're worried about touching the basket. The guy who handles the money has never gotten that terrible virusy thing that we speak about. And so I joke about it and I say it's a holy basket. So if you touch it, you'll be healed. I'm kidding. You won't be. Well, maybe you will be. I don't know. But it's a good way of just teaching us to steward our money well. Jesus says, you know, give to me of your first offerings. And this really what it is. It's about something we do collectively for the greater good of the community and for Jesus. And so if you've come prepared to give of your tithes and your offerings, we will now gladly receive. Thank you.
Hey, good morning. If I haven't met you, my name is Tony, one of the leaders here, and I have the privilege of sharing with you this morning. Before we get into what I have to share, just a report back. Last week, I went with a group of guys to Hillbrow. We went to preach in a church there that was planted out of this church, a guy by the name of George, and he's from the DRC, so it's a beautiful community of refugees from the DRC, and we took 15,000 rand with us. We didn't take it in cash because we didn't think that was a good idea. But from you guys gave 15,000 rand. That's a lot of money for them. These refugees are a lot of money. I can be so silly. Like I wanted to take the money in because of the risk. But then one of the guys said, but now you're putting the people at risk. I said, you stupid things, eh? I wanted to be able to say I went into Hillbrow with 15 grand. You don't pray for me. Why don't you need to be praying harder for me that I don't think like that. But anyway, we went and blessed them. It was great. Had a great time. Now we're back. Good to see you here. I want to share something a little different this morning. I'm not going to be preaching to you. I'm more going to be sharing my heart. And I've shared this before. I shared this with the leaders, 100 of our leaders, a few weeks ago. And it's the same, similar thing because I felt that, or Susanna and I felt that you needed to hear this. I want everyone to hear this talk from our hearts, you know. Because we need to ask the question, what are we building? So when we came, when God sent us from KZN 22 years ago to plant 4S Community Church, we came with an idea, we came with a thought, we came very intentional about what we wanted to build, and we had an idea of what we wanted to see. Of course, God's building his church, and we co-labor with him. The Bible says we must make disciples, which we are, but when it comes to the church, and the church that is built around a local community, of course it's going to have a lot of the expression of the lead, the founder of the church. That's just a reality. And we want to, as best as we can, get out of the way to make sure that Jesus is in the way, you know. But of course, our desire and our ethos and our values and our style are going to come across. That's just a reality. We don't apologize for that. It is what it is. But we want to grow. We want to learn. We want to change. We want to be teachable. And so I asked a question to you this morning, what are we building? And I'm going to be sharing what we felt in our hearts all these years ago with you. You know, my wife and I and my entire family came and gave up everything to plant this church. And we had a very clear picture of what we wanted to see. You know, it's taken me 32 years to build a marriage. She's still got a lot of work to be done on, and more so on me. It's been a long time. We're still busy. To build a solid marriage takes at least 32 years to get to the beginning. And now we're cruising. We're alone. We're empty nest. Good thing I like her a little bit, because it's just her and I. Good thing she likes me a little bit too. But we've had 4 children and 6 grandchildren. We've had many obstacles, many highs, many lows, many hijackers that have come our way to try and derail us, which we just said there's no chance. And I'm prepared to give the rest of my life to this marriage, and I'm prepared to give another 20 years to the life of this church. I don't know if you're going to want me around for that long, but I could be around another 20 years. So, and some of you are going to look really old. I'm working to keep myself looking young because I want to look as old as some of you in 20 years' time. But so we are on this journey. On Friday night, we saw some of the fruit of what we dreamt about, I dreamt about on the hills of Nkwavuma. I built a hospital there, an extension to a hospital in Nkwavuma. It's north, about 3 hours' drive north of Empangeni in the hills, KwaZulu-Natal, Zululand Hills. And I would drive there once a week to the site, and I would dream about the church because we already knew we were going to plant the church. And we saw something of that on Friday night. We've seen many pockets in the church of life that's happening and being lived that we dreamt about. But this particular one I want to make reference to. I was with a group of FCCers at a hotel celebrating a beautiful lady in our church's 40th birthday celebration. There were black, white, Indian, and colored members of 4S Community Church at this event. Different races, different tribes, different nationalities, different generations. And it was so beautiful to see that. Charles asked me at the event, he said, reflecting on the crowd, he said, did you envisage this when you dreamt about the church? I said, this is way beyond what I could ever have imagined. The beauty and the diversity and the different cultures mingling, it was a beautiful thing. And so that was great to see. That's what we are building. We're building that. We're not building an event. We're not building a program, a bunch of courses, a meeting, an organization. And if you're new here, I want you to hear this morning, because this church might not be for you. I hope in God it is for you. But if you're looking for something other than what I'm going to share today, then it's not for you. This is not going to change. It's just going to get better. We're not saying that we're great at what we are building. We can get better, but we're not going to build differently. This is what we are building. This is what we gave our lives to, and this is not going to change, because I believe this is biblical. I believe it's God's way when it comes to the life of the church. If you're older, I want to remind you about these values and principles and the culture that we're trying to build, because culture can leak, values can leak. And so we're on this journey. It says this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. Jesus taught his disciples to pray. And Jesus says, pray like this: Our Father, who art in heaven. I love that. He doesn't say pray my Father, because often Western society can be very individualistic. My Father. No, it's our. There's an Ubuntu to this. I'm sure Ubuntu is a biblical word that's been translated into Zulu. But there is. Koinonia is a Greek word that means community. And I think it's very similar. Our Father. He's our Father. I'm not your friends. If you're a born-again Christian, I'm not your friend. I'm your brother. You have to look at it differently. We were celebrated. I hope the lady that was, whose event we went to celebrate, I hope she's here at the 11 o'clock, because she said, she introduced us as her friends. I can say, you actually made a mistake there. We're not your friends. We're your brothers and sisters. And I'll do that respectfully, but that's the truth. We're brothers and sisters. It's deeper. It's more meaningful. It's biblical and it's right. And so when we got saved, we became children, it says it in John. We became children of God, not members of a church or members of a global entity. We became children of God. And the Bible says we called to our Father, Abba Father. We use the word Abba. Like they say the translation could be like calling him daddy. And I don't like to call God daddy, but he's like a daddy to us. But he's Father, and we are sons and daughters. And this is a scripture in Acts chapter 2 that we've kept foundational to all that we always do, all that we've ever done, and we want to go into the future. This needs to represent us. The early church, we want to build something that looks a little bit like, or a lot like the early church. It says they devoted themselves, these early disciples, they devoted themselves. They didn't have to wait for an announcement or an email or an SMS or Instagram post to remind them. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. I think come down with me should be called breaking of bread, because that's what we do there. We're breaking bread in fellowship together, having a meal, remembering what Christ had done for us. So much more meaningful than doing it on a Sunday morning, and I believe we're sharing with one another. Says, and awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. Isn't that amazing? They were selling their excess or their stuff, their belongings, their proceeds, and giving to people who had need. And day by day, attending the temple together. This is like a kind of modern-day temple gathering. They attended the temple together and breaking bread in their homes. They were in homes as well. If you're not in a home group, I would encourage you, get into a home group. Do temple and house worship together. They received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who have been saved. This is what we want to build, friends. This is what I believe God sent us from KZN to build. Something that looks like the New Testament model of believers doing life together, not a bunch of courses or some program or some organizational structure. Now, we can have some structure, but I believe church, by and large, has become over-structured, and I'll share with you why I believe that. It's not some entertainment. This is not a stage that we perform off. This is a pulpit that we minister from. This is a holy place. I never get into this pulpit thinking that I can preach. I get in here with humility. I never get in here as best as I can. I try not to show off or try and impress. I'm not actually trying to be friends with you either, because you're my brothers and sisters. And I'm not trying to be nice either. I'm trying to be as faithful as I can to my God, who's given me the privilege to stand on this holy ground. It's not a place to impress or to entertain. It's a pulpit. And often across the world, it's become something other than a pulpit. I don't know what it is. But I came across this gentleman by the name of Bob Mumford. He's a Bible teacher in the 1980s. And he gave me some perspective as to what I'm going to be teaching or sharing with you this morning. And I did some research then, and I've done some research and preparation here. And if you look at the different cultures and nations and influence that different nations have had over the world, you'll see that the Western world was highly influenced by the ancient Greeks. Now, you might say we're living in Africa, but our context here is very westernized. Our mindset is very westernized, and that mindset was influenced tremendously by Greek culture. Plato and Socrates and Aristotle and teachers like that had great influence, in particular on early church fathers. So the Greeks gave us a different look at art and commerce and government, and they were very structural and very organizational and had a tremendously positive influence on societies or the world as a whole. So no, please hear me if there's any Greek people or Greek speaking people in the life of the church. This is what I want to say. But when it comes to the church, those structures don't belong in the church. They belong in the world, and they function well. Well, I think they belong in the world. They function well, And I'm not critical of the Greek society in any way, positive influence on culture. But when it comes to church life, our model and our mindset needs to be different, needs to be more from a Hebrew mindset. And I'll explain as I go. If you look at how leaders were appointed in the church, what were the qualifications of leaders? Now, there's lots of business people here. You either in business yourself, you've employed by a company, or otherwise you're an employer, you employ people in your company. And when it comes to leaders, what do you look for? I think things like education. And most often you need to have a degree to get a job. You could be useless. All you got is head knowledge, but you're useless, but you got the degree. It's good that you got the degree and some skill. Experience you look for. Confidence. Are they articulate? Are they skilled? Now, sure, you need people. You need people with skill and some education. But we don't look to those things when it comes to leaders in the life of the church. Not one of those things I've mentioned. Gift, education, charisma aren't mentioned at all. As you'll see, it's all about character. You don't study to become a pastor like you study for every other occupation you possibly find yourself in. You had to study to be that or to be in that position. Not for a pastor. A pastor's called. You can't go to university, study a degree, get a theological degree, and now you say, I'm a pastor. No, you're called. This is a calling that God places upon certain individuals. And then, of course, it's good for you to study so you can be a better pastor, but you can't study to become a pastor. That's nonsense. You can't self-appoint either. You can't say, I'm going to be. There needs to be some testing in a community. There needs to be some recognition by others. And there's so many self-appointed teachers in the church. It's like, who appointed you? Who recognizes you? What are you teaching? Who are you accountable to? You can't just go, you can't come to me and just say, listen, I'm sick, I've got this, can you tell me what medicine can I take? I've got no education and no experience, you wouldn't come to me. Why would you think people should come to you if you've got no recognition or testing or experience in the life of the church or no character? Your character hasn't been tested. You see, there needs to be some fruit, and people, the community will see the fruit. It's like a leader. Somebody said, if you say you're a leader and we look behind you and nobody's following you, you're not a leader. You're just going for a walk with your dog, possibly. But it says this in 1 Timothy chapter 3. Now, an overseer, that's somebody that leads a church or an elder, a pastor, he needs to be above reproach, faithful to his wife. You ever asked anyone when you've interviewed them, if you're an owner of a company, are you faithful to your wife? I bet you've never, ever asked that. Have you ever been for an interview? Anyone of you been to an interview? Has anyone ever asked you, have you been faithful to your wife? If I was a company owner and I asked you that, have you been faithful to your wife? And you say no, it's like, I'm not going to employ you. Unless you said yes, maybe I was once, but I repented, I asked for forgiveness. Okay, that's different. But if you're unfaithful right now, I'm not going to employ you at all. Temperate, self-controlled, respectable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well. Have you ever asked someone over there? Have you ever put that on your CV? I'm faithful to my wife. I manage my family well. That's what I'm looking for. And see that his children obey him. Ever interviewed somebody and said, do your children obey you? Or they're unruly? That's a reflection. He must do so in a manner worthy of respect. He must have a good reputation with outsiders. Maybe going into the future, whenever we appoint another leader, I need to go to your place of employee and ask your subordinates or your colleagues or your bosses, what kind of reputation has so-and-so got in the workplace? Would you like that? We should be able to. You see, a good pastor is a good husband and a good father. Am I a good husband? I got like this. Which is all right. It's not that, at least. I got this. I'm a good father. I got this in the first meeting, and now it's going up a little bit. Am I a good dad? I got a good dad. Good. At least I'm there and there. And what should the church look like? The church is an extension of the family. Elders have authority. not a badge or a position or a title or a gift or a degree. Elders have authority, and this authority is tested where? In the home. If you're not a good dad or a good husband, you can't be a pastor. I've never met a man who's a good father, good husband, managed his home and abused people. You see, if he was to be abusive to people, where would he do it first? In the home. I went to a church once. I may have shared this with you. But let me do it again because it's so powerful. And I met this man, and he was telling me about the church, and I had this uncomfortable feeling about him, like discerning something. Something's not right with this guy. I just could sense something. So later on, I went to the lead pastor, and I said, tell me about Joe Black here. I had a very uncomfortable feeling about him. Oh, no, he's one of our top leaders. He's a preacher. He preaches, I preach most, and then secondly, he does most of the preaching in the life of the church. I said, yeah, I had a funny feeling. That's strange, the pastor said. I said, well, just tell me about his family. Tell me about his wife and his kids. Oh, it's a problem. You know, his wife has left him. She lives in another country. His kids have left him as well. It's very sad. But you must hear him preach. He's amazing. Dude, you've missed the plot there. Missed it. You see, I learned this principle from this guy, Bob Mumford. He calls it the principle of mumps and measles. If I've got mumps and I preach measles to you, what are you going to get? You're going to get mumps. See, you can teach people on courage and instill fear. You can teach one thing and impart another. Somebody said this, or let me say this. You see, what a man teaches is not what you catch. What he is what you catch. Somebody said this, what you are shouts so loud in my ears, I cannot hear what you're saying. It's powerful. That got into my spirit. What you are shouts so loud in my ears, I can't even hear what you're saying. That's what you impart. Not what you teach, you impart who you are. And hopefully what you teach and who you are together. See, that's why everything that we do in the life of the church, when it comes to leadership and everything, is rooted in the home. What are you at home? If you're one thing at home and a different thing at church, there's a problem. Disqualified. So Mr. Elder, Mr. Wannabe Elder, let me see your home. Let me see your family. We're not looking for perfection, but we're looking for some reality. The New Testament was written in Greek, but written by Hebrews. So it's written with a Hebrew philosophy, not a structured organizational philosophy. With the Hebrew, it needs to be interpreted, the Bible, from a Hebrew point of view. Jesus was a Jew, the disciples were a Jew, Paul and Timothy were Jews, and so the Jews thought in a very different way to Greeks. See, when it comes to church life, we need to approach it with a Hebrew model, not a Greek structured organizational model. And that's what the Greeks were great at. They gave the world, they impacted the world tremendously with structure and organization and business and events and courses and programs. And many of our churches have become that. If you say with a Greek kind of mindset, when you say leader, they think straight away a person, not a Greek person, but a person with that kind of Western thinking. They think CEO when you say leader. They think boss, executive pastor. I saw an advert the other day for an executive pastor. What on earth is an executive pastor? It's a guy that carries a suitcase and wears a black tie. It's nonsense. It's a hierarchy. If you think that one day I want to be a leader in the church and because, you know, if I'm a good Christian, I become a deacon. If I'm a good deacon, I become an elder. If I'm a good elder, I become a pastor. You don't understand Hebrew thinking. It's got nothing to do with hierarchy. It's got to do with function and role. I'm not the most important person in this church. I just have a different role to most of you. I'm equal. I stand at the cross level ground with you and I. We stand together. I don't stand on a pedestal. I stand with you. I'm your brother. I was going to say, and your sister. No, I'm your brother. You're my sister. You see, when you, with Hebrew thinking, it's first not about structure or organization. It's about family first. They think family. When you say leader to somebody with Hebrew philosophy, you say leader, they think father. They think family. They think relationship. They think shepherding. This changed my life because when I first was called to be a pastor, before I became a pastor, I was called. I was recognized by others. I thought, I can't do this, what I saw in the 80s. The guys and the girls that were on the stage, it was a stage. They could perform. It was like, when they opened their mouths, were like honey dripping. They were so articulate. I couldn't do that. And they could gather thousands, and they were brilliant at administration, all that stuff, and organization. And I thought, I can't do that. I'm not gifted enough. But when I came across this model, it's about family. I can do family. I can do relationships. I can love people and I can be with people and build with people. That I like. But when it comes to the performance, I can't perform. That's got me excited. I didn't want to plant a church because I thought I had to be like this, but like that, like a father. I can be like a father to people. I can be like a shepherd to people. And so this changed my thinking. You see, when you look at the New Testament, it's all about a father. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Whoever comes through me goes to heaven. No, he didn't say that. We even say that. We say, you need to have Jesus to get to heaven. No. I know it's a place, but Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father, to a family, not to a place. I know it is a place, but it's a person first. Change your thinking. Everything Jesus did was to bring us to the Father. He came to do his Father's will. He was building a family. And that's what I got saved into. I didn't get saved into a church. In 1986, I got saved. I didn't want to get saved into a church, into a system, into a bunch of courses or set of meetings. I wanted to get saved into a family. I was looking for brothers and sisters. I was looking for community, not a corporation or not an institution. And that's why everything we do must be rooted in family. Doesn't mean we don't have any structure. Of course, we have some structure, but we're not organizational in our thinking. We're organized in what we do. You come to my home, there's some structure to, if you're going to come for a meal, there's a certain time that you arrive, give or take. Doesn't have to be, like we're so regimental, some of us, it's like 6 o'clock dinner, you better be there at 6. It's like, what if on my way, somebody needed me, and I get there at 6:15, and I gave them, no, it was 6 o'clock, we made it. Now you're upset that they came a little late. It's like, but don't come at 7 if they say 6. That's a bit stretching it now, okay? Okay? So I'm clapping all of you. Now we have some plan as to what we're going to eat. We're going to eat and we're going to have some fun. And there's going to be, in my home, there's going to be a going home time. That's the most important because some of you like to care. You like there till 12 midnight. I want to go to bed. So I've learned a trick from Susanna's dad. When he's ready for you to go home, he'll stand up and say, let's just pray as you leave and pray God's blessing over you. And then you're out of the door. But some of you, it's time to leave. We go to the car. On the way to the car, it takes half an hour from the down to the car. It's like, come on, man, 5 minutes and get out of here. I asked a friend, a brother in the life of the church, if I could share the story. I didn't want to dishonor anything or anyone. But he's in our church now. He was in another church for 8 years. He was the worship leader. 8 years. He was leading worship. Never once did he visit the lead pastor's home or him meet in his home to have a meal. Never once. I was asking him on Friday night if I could share the story because it's just profound. It's like, so illustrates what I'm trying to say. I said, did you ever, am I dishonoring the other pastor? He says, no, nobody knows it about it, so you know, you will never know who it is. So I said, did you ever have a coffee? Just sit down with the lead guy and have a coffee and just talk about life. He says, no, never. Every meeting was functional. So he said, doesn't even know you. And you in the pulpit? It's like, there's never going to be somebody in this pulpit that I don't know. Ever. I want to know about your family, your relationship with your wife, your kids. How on earth would I put somebody here with a gift? I don't know anything about their life. It's madness, I think. See, many churches are run like businesses. I'm not trying to rip off any other churches. Maybe the reality is you don't like the way this church functions, and you're looking for more business-like organizational. There's lots of churches in four ways. But this church is never going to run like that, never function like that. We want to function like a family. We're not better. We just want to be different. We want to operate like a family. I had somebody once visit and say, this is the first question they ask. I've had many people do this. They ask, what courses do you run? What courses do we run? This is a family. I don't run a course in my family how my wife can be a better wife. Or my children, how they can be better kids. We do life. What courses do you run? I said, and people over the years have asked, so what ministries do you have? What are ministries? We don't have any ministries. Oh, men's ministry, women's ministry. We have men and women. We have ladies' gatherings. We have men's gatherings. We don't have a ministry. Ministry to the poor, ministry to this, ministry to that. We just do life. We don't have any of that. So what do you have for me? A family. People ask, what should we do in the life of the church? Nothing initially. Just get into the family and build relationship. Yeah, but I want to serve. Build family first, and then your gift will make way for you. It's not difficult to be part of this church. Some of you might think it's difficult to be part of this church. It's not difficult. You can come to a looking in. You know what a looking in is? And then straight away you can become part of a home group. And if you look around and you say, oh, it's difficult to be part of this church. Remember, Charles was saying, remember, a lot of these people have been in relationship for 15 years. You can't blame them for that. And you can't build what they've built in 15 years in 15 months. We've done life together. But get on the journey with us. Get into a home group. And get on the journey with us. And in 15 years, maybe you can have the same relationship. It's not that it's difficult. You can press in here. You can be part of this if you have a Hebrew mindset. Maybe there's something else you're looking for. Maybe this is not the place where you should be. I hope it is. But if you're looking for more organizational kind of Christianity, where it's, couldn't that be better? Couldn't that be more on time? Couldn't that be more slick? This is a family. Amen? This is brothers and sisters on mission together. This is not a stage. This is a pulpit. You've heard me say this. I want to reiterate this. This is a pulpit that we minister from, not where we perform. And in many places across the globe, this has become a stage where pastors and worship leaders show off. They're showboating and acting. You've seen it. It's like I don't understand. And I'm not talking about any particular culture. I don't understand. And she said, and now, hallelujah. What on earth is that? I watch this other guy, and he's preaching. I know, I'm looking. I look like a madman, I know. It's madness. It's like, what on earth? Shut up and say something that I can understand. It's not a stage to impress. It's a pulpit to impart. I just messed my throat up as messed as it is. I don't know how these guys do it and keep their voice. This is not a stage to inform. It's a pulpit to transform. Hopefully the preaching that comes with this pulpit pierces your hearts and changes you. It's not a stage to entertain. It's a pulpit to equip. Now let me close with Justin Bieber again. We played a video in the church the other day. It was great. It was funky. It was awesome during our tithe, but it disturbed me because in my opinion, and I could be wrong, it was very showy, entertaining, showing off, in my view. That same band had Justin Bieber in the pulpit. I saw a YouTube video and it disturbed me. Yes, Justin Bieber on a worship team in a pulpit, in my view, showing off and making worship entertainment. It disturbed me. I don't want to ever see any of these people trying to show off. They can be skilled in what they're doing and that, and they can have some charisma, but they're not looking for any attention, because you can be on a worship team or in a pulpit and you get off that pulpit and people say, wow, aren't you amazing? There's another way to do it. When you get off the pulpit and people say, God is amazing, not the person. So if you know Justin Bieber, you tell him Pastor T said, get off the pulpit and get back on the stage where you belong. But stay out of my pulpit. I want to protect my pulpit. He will never be in the only thing he'll be is giving a testimony if his life is right. Because straight after that, I went and researched his music. Again, I think he's brilliant. His music is brilliant. But I went and looked at his latest album. There's a song about God, God, God. The next song, he's dropping F-bombs the whole song. Dropping F-bombs his whole song. And then he's in the, oh, praise the Lord. Nonsense. I don't know what you think. Maybe I've offended you. Maybe you love Bieber. I love Jesus. And I don't want Bieber to spoil and contaminate the pulpit. He's brilliant. Did we go? I was supposed to go to a Justin Bieber concert with my daughter. I don't know. We didn't make it. I'd love to go to a concert. I think he's great. But not in the pulpit, buddy. Can you send me his email address? Well, I'm going to WhatsApp him. Say, I love you, my brother, because he's a believer in Christ. But I want to say to him, listen, stay off the pulpit and clean up your tongue. Pastor T said, write some music without F-bombs in it, my buddy. And I want to say to that other worship team that invited him, how dare you invite him onto the stage? Okay, I better stop now. Justin Bieber, listen to me, you chop. He doesn't care who on earth I am. I'm absolutely nothing, and I'm happy to be nothing. I'm a son of God. Should we pray? Let's pray. Would you stand with me, please? Father, I hope I didn't do anything wrong this morning in the pulpit. And that's every Sunday. Lord, I don't know how you tolerate me, but you love me, I know that. And I want to be passionately representing you and as best as I can. This needs to be about you and not about us. And if I ever make it about you, please forgive me, sorry, Lord. If I ever make it about myself, use us, Lord, to build the right model church that gives you honor. May we always, if ever we get into the pulpit, may we always make it about you and not about us. Forgive us our sin, Lord, of looking for attention, of performing on the stage, of entertaining. Help us live a life with that mindset where it's about family, brothers and sisters, the one another's. We have a Father in heaven. Jesus is our brother. He's our Lord and a brother, and you are Father. May everyone in this church know you as their Father. If you're here this morning and you don't know the Father, you have to come through Jesus, the Son of God. But just call upon him, and he'll become your Father too, and you'll become my brother and my sister. Nothing, very few things give me more joy than to see people being added to the family. God bless you. God be with you. May his face shine upon you, and may he protect you from all evil. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless. Thank you.